joining us today for worship at First Baptist Church in McDonough, Georgia. Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Let's sing this together. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise, and give him praise. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart. Your voice is raised, your voice is raised. Give glory and honor and power unto him. Jesus, the name above all names. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise. And give him praise. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart. Your voice is raised. Your voice is raised. Give glory and honor and power unto him. Jesus, the name above all.
I will rise among the saints. was when he ran to me
He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise when God ran. I left home. I knew I'd broken his heart. I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me. And down that dusty road ahead I could see it was the only time. It was the only time I ever saw him run. And then he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you? He caught me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees when God ran. Now I know that he's been waiting for this day. I saw him run to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, I felt his love for me again. He ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, he called me son. He said, son, do you know I still love you?
The phrase, he's the GOAT. We hear this a lot in the world of sports. Tom Brady is the GOAT of NFL quarterbacks, or Jack Nicklaus is the GOAT of the PGA golf world. Serena Williams is the GOAT of female tennis. We hear that a lot. GOAT meaning, of course, the greatest of all time. Michael Jordan, the greatest of all time. He's the GOAT in NBA basketball. We could also say that, you know, maybe Albert Einstein is the GOAT of astrophysiology, right? Astrophysics. Or we could say that maybe Michelangelo was the GOAT of Renaissance art. We could say quite possibly Madame Curie was the GOAT in her lifetime. King Solomon was the goat of wisdom when it came to kingly leadership. We've all heard those things. Great people put into categories reserved usually only for one person, one man, one woman. There are no others like them. No one else can compare to their intellect or their athletic prowess, whatever it might be, in whatever field they have set their life's course. Now, it's not necessarily true that they are the greatest of all time, because let's face it, people argue from time to time as to who's the greatest. LeBron. King LeBron, he's the greatest of all time. No, Michael Jordan is the greatest of all time. And the debate goes on, right? In the goat of any profession, probably, there are many individuals who are yet to even arrive on planet Earth who very well may supersede those who we call in our generation the greatest of all time. Someone's going to come along and beat their record, or outthink them when it comes to general relativity or whatever the arena might be. But you know what? There is one who stands alone from all the rest. There is one in whom no one else can possibly compare. Literally, there is no category under which he would fit when it comes to mere mortals. And you know who I'm talking about. It's a pretty simple answer if you've been to church at all for any time. We want to talk about Jesus today. His name is Jesus. And so we go to John chapter 3. We go back to that midnight conversation around that campfire that Jesus has with one of Israel's greatest religious scholars, a man who knew the Bible backwards and forwards, who didn't realize that evening he was coming to introduce himself to the inspiration behind the Bible, who the entire Bible is centered around. And every prophecy, every Old Testament story, every Old Testament prophet or Bible figure is someone or something or some truth that was literally pointing to the person of Jesus who would one day come into the world. And he came at a time when Nicodemus was alive. Nicodemus is very curious. He's a bit of a skeptic, but not like so many other of the religious leaders who had abandon any concept of Jesus possibly being the Messiah. Nicodemus really still wasn't sure, and he really wanted to know. Was he the Savior of the world? Religious scholars wanted to know, and they had made their conclusions. The problem is most of them never even bothered to ask Jesus. The religious scholars of Jesus' day wanted to hold on to their power base. They wanted to continue to have their influence over God's people instead of allowing the Son of God who created the world and God's people to step in and have influence in their lives. So it was a clash of clashes. They did not recognize that Jesus truly was the greatest of all time. And beyond that, he was in a category no other human could fill. We have the beauty of looking back 20 centuries to the life of Jesus, the great theologians along the centuries who have helped us to decipher many of the truest meanings of Jesus, who he is and who he was, and who he will always be, and some of his great teaching. Some of the things that we saw him in the scriptures do while he was living on this earth. In John chapter 3, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, comes to Jesus in the night. Look with me in the scripture. A Pharisee named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council, that's the Sanhedrin. These are the ones who would bring Jesus before Pilate to be crucified for blasphemy. He came to Jesus at night, a secret follower of Christ, and he says, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, or no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Verily I say unto thee, no one shall see the kingdom of God unless you are born again." Jesus was skipping all of the accolades, all of the accomplishments, all of the platitudes from Nicodemus, and he goes right to the heart of the matter. He didn't want to beat around the bush with Nicodemus, but he was saying to him, "Nicodemus, all of your religion, your religiosity, your religious scholarship, your understanding of God's divine truth means absolutely zero unless you have been born a second time." Nicodemus really didn't know what he was saying. How can someone be born when they're old? Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. And Jesus answers, "I say truly to you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless you are born of water," meaning a physical birth, "and born of the Spirit," meaning a spiritual birth, a second birth, a being born again. Jesus goes on to say, "Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit is the one, the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the Spirit, who gives birth to the Spirit." "Why would you be surprised then," Jesus said, "when I tell you, you must be born again? Everyone's been talking about it for millennia. And Nicodemus, you're supposed to know the scriptures." And if we move down, now that's the subtext for the verses I really want to get to today. And the most famous passage in all the Bible. We kind of know it by heart. But I want to zero in on one phrase. Not the phrase "the greatest of all time," but yeah, kind of the phrase "the greatest of all time," but just said in a different way. Jesus says in verse 16, "God so loved the world, Nicodemus, that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Notice that phrase in the scripture, God's one and only son. It kind of sounds like Jesus has kind of repeated himself. If he's the one, well, then he's the only one. If he's the only one, why would you need to say he's the one? But Jesus is actually trying to reference two very different concepts of God's Son. Now, Jesus, of course, is talking about himself because he is God the Son. Sounds like John is repeating himself, but he's actually referencing two very distinct aspects of Jesus' life, being this, the one, Jesus, God's one, the one is a reference to his divinity as Messiah. He is the one who has come into the world. And he's the only one is a reference to his humanity, but his uniqueness within the context of humanity, because Jesus is the greatest of all time. Jesus is the God-man. Jesus was 100% God as if he were not even man, but Jesus was also 100% man as if he were not God. There has been no one else like Jesus, nor will there ever be anyone else like Jesus. He alone, and this is why, he alone saved the world from sin. Read the gospel writings of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We find that Jesus is totally unique. He is born of great miraculous means. A virgin gives birth to a child. She's overshadowed by the Holy Spirit. On one nanosecond, she's not pregnant with a child, and the next nanosecond, she's pregnant with a child. This is a great mystery. We cannot even begin to fathom this. Although what we see, when you think about it, in modern science today, there is miraculous means, though we understand them scientifically and medically, for a non-pregnant woman to all of a sudden be pregnant within the context of an office where some technique like in vitro fertilization takes place, right? We get that in our day and time. Still this incredible miracle of Jesus' life, and Jesus leads this perfect life, this sinless life, this loving, caring, compassionate life. He teaches us all of these divine truths. He shows grace and humility when others were only showing condemnation and hate. Jesus is healing the lame, the blind, the deaf, the dead. And then he goes to the cross and he dies our death on a cross, but God raises him from the dead gloriously, from the dead, and in his resurrection, we have our proof that when we die, we too will be raised from the dead. And then there's that moment where Christ ascends into heaven, another great mystery. So we see this incredible life that Jesus led. He is the one, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, but he's the only one, because there's no other human being like him, nor will there ever be. Now, that's kind of what I wanted to talk about today. But before I do, I want to chase a rabbit. I love this. Most people in our church, when they hear me start chasing rabbits, I can see them immediately perk up and sit on the edge of their seat, because I have no idea what I'm going to say next. In this case, I actually have written some of this down, because I don't want to confuse anybody or make anybody misunderstand what I'm trying to say. But I want to chase this rabbit for a minute. You know, when you share your faith, you're going to come across people who are mostly ambivalent about coming to Christ and giving their lives to Jesus, probably at first. You very well may just simply plant a seed in their mind, maybe in their heart. Maybe they look at you and they go, wow, this person is normal, and yet they have a spiritual life. Maybe there's something to that. And maybe they'll begin their own journey. So it might just be planting a seed. But other times you'll come across somebody who's not ambivalent, or you're not just planting a seed, but they're kind of hostile toward you. I mean, they want you out of their lives, out of their world as fast as you came. Leave. I don't want you in my life. I don't want you talking to me. You know, I've told you about some of my adventures in Ethiopia. I've spoken many times about being arrested for sharing the gospel, but on one occasion, I wasn't preaching at that time, I was just a part of the group, but on one occasion when I was preaching, we were preaching to probably 10,000 people out in this open market in a little village in Ethiopia near Lake Awassa, and this huge brick goes flying by my head, and it nearly hits my translator. Now, it went behind me. I never even saw it, but everybody there says that the person throwing it was aiming at my head. And everybody in the behind me, they did see the brick coming my way, or coming our way. So they hit the deck, and I'm preaching away, but I hear something strange going on in the back, and I look around, and about that time my translator grabs me and pulls me down into the truck, and the truck just immediately takes off, endangering several people's lives, maybe including our own, and there became this riot. And as I picked my head up to see really what was going on, I looked back, and you don't want to know what they were doing to this individual who threw a brick at us. But that individual and some others there had been plotting that, apparently. It was what they wanted to do, disrupt our opportunity to share the gospel. Sometimes you're going to have that. You got to be careful. I got home from work one evening just last week. And Leslie said, she's a dental hygienist for a very prestigious periodontist in our community, Dr. Reagan Failer. And she, every now and then, she'll see church members and she'll say, hey, somebody says hello to you. And I usually say, well, who is it? And she says, I can't tell you. It's against the law for me to tell you, but they said hello. And I said, I usually say, okay, well, tell them I said hello. I don't even know who it is. And she did that again just this past week. And she said, hey, somebody says hello. And I said, oh, well, tell them I said hello. And she said, well, you don't actually know them. And I said, well, who is it? And she goes, I can't tell you. And she says, but I will tell you this, because he told me to tell you his story. He said he prided himself for many, many years kicking Baptist preachers off of his front porch and watching them sulk away back to their car and leave as he was berating them and, as he said, you know, probably using some very colorful language as they left. He said he was so proud of himself that he and his son started doing that together. When the Baptist preachers came to the front porch, they would go to the door, mock and berate them, and they would walk off. He said, rarely did any Baptist preacher ever come back except this one. He wouldn't give up on me. So he said to my wife this past week, he says, tell your pastor, never give up on anybody, even if they're hostile towards him. He said, because I was one of those guys. And I thank God, and in this case it was a Baptist preacher, he said, I thank God for that Baptist preacher who refused to give up on me. Don't give up on your family. Don't give up on your friends. Don't give up on a coworker who seems hostile or angry with you for just sharing your faith. Don't berate them with the gospel. Don't share the gospel just to watch them squirm. But if there comes a time and you have opportunity and you can do so in a clever way that might make a connection, you know, connect the spiritual dots for them, do so. Don't give up, even if they have been hostile to you. It's incredibly important. That's the rabbit I wanted to chase. And this is what Jesus is doing with Nicodemus. All the religious leaders have basically given up on Jesus. Not that he cared, because he knew they were all wrong. I mean, they were literally talking to truth in human flesh. So he knew they had a misinterpretation of his divine truth by the way that he actually inspired. But he wasn't going to give up on Nicodemus, and he wasn't going to give up on Joseph of Arimathea and a few others who said, I really want to know who this man is. So what does the one and only mean? Let me give you three very quick points and we'll wrap this up, okay? Number one is it means Jesus is the true teacher of divine truth. Oh, don't sell yourself short, Pastor Charles. You're a great teacher of the truth. Yeah, but that's just it. I'm just a messenger of the truth. I take the truth, and as a herald, I try to teach and preach in the best way I possibly can, try to keep you awake. Okay, some of you, I see you. You fall asleep. All right, but that's okay. But I do my best. But here's the deal. I'm just transferring the message of God to you. God and God alone, Jesus, his son, is the true teacher of divine truth, for he is the personification of divine truth. When you grasp a spiritual concept, and maybe I'm preaching it, or maybe I'm teaching it, and I've seen this happen over and over again, and people will on occasion come up and say, hey, thank you so much, I now understand what it is that particular passage is trying to communicate. And I get it, and I'm responding to it, and I'm acting upon it. And I usually say, man, that's fantastic. But I almost never say thank you, because I'm not the inspiration of divine truth as a teacher. I'm a herald. The Spirit of God, whom Jesus sent on his behalf when Jesus' work was accomplished at the cross, is the divine teacher of truth. And Jesus, of course, is the personification of that truth, the manifestation of divine truth in human flesh, right? Just a herald, just a teacher. Jesus said in John 14, the advocate is going to come, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name and will teach you all things and will remind you of every single thing that I said to you while on earth. So my peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. And I don't give you peace as the world gives you peace. That's a phony peace. That's a chump change peace. That's a short-term peace. I give you lasting peace. Because the peace I give you is the peace between you and God. That's exactly what, by the way, that's exactly what Nicodemus said to Jesus, isn't it? He said, teacher, we know you have been sent by God. Everywhere Jesus went, he was called the good teacher. People say that all the time, said that all the time to Jesus. That's what they were saying. good teacher is a translation for teacher sent from God. And that's what Nicodemus is saying here. Remember, Jesus says to his disciples on the night he was betrayed, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. That is divine truth. Manifest in Jesus' words. Among many other things Jesus was trying to communicate, of course, was that he is the truth that leads to the way to eternal life. Eternal life is found when we're confronted with the truth and then we begin to follow the way to eternal life. And by the way, there's a lot of great truths out there. There's a lot of great paths out there that will lead you to a really good life. A lot of world religions teach a lot of really good things that will help you have a good life. But as followers of Christ, we not only want you to have a good life, we want you to have everlasting life, eternal life with God in heaven forever. And that is only found through Jesus. All the paths that lead to God lead through the cross of Jesus. The teacher of divine truth. We don't want you just to have a great life. We want you to have eternal life. And that's the second point there, because Jesus is, and I've mentioned this now a couple times, but he's the visual representation of God on earth. In John chapter 14, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but through me. And he goes on to say, if you really know me, you will know my Father as well. And then here's what he said. And I imagine if he had a pair of glasses, he would have probably done this from now on. It's such a dramatic scene. I think of Robert Powell's representation of Jesus in Franco Zeffirelli's Jesus of Nazareth, or Jim Caviezel's representation of Jesus in Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ. Such brilliant work on these two actors portraying Jesus. Jesus leans into his disciples around that Last Supper table and he says, from now on, you do know God, and you have seen him. Wow. And Jesus lays it all on the line. Guys, you have seen God because I am God in human flesh. Jesus, God's one and only Son. No other like him. I want to move on very, very quickly. We're out of time, and I want to get to this one point that I've been sort of knocking on for a little while here now, and that is, of course, my last point that I want to make. But when I say I've been knocking on this idea, I think it's critically important that we understand Jesus and Jesus alone, God's one and only Son, is the only doorway to eternal life. Folks, you cannot find eternal life through any other means. I mean, there's all kinds of ideas, man-made ideas, you know, man trying to reach up and think about what maybe eternity's like, or what God is like, if there's a God at all, or what maybe is beyond the grave. That was all concluded for us through the person of Jesus when God came in human form to earth, to live among us, to show us the way, to teach us his truths, and to become the doorway to eternal life. I love what Paul told the Corinthian believers in his second letter. He said, and he died, meaning Jesus, for all, that those who should live no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in that very same way, we do so no longer, because if anyone is in Christ, Paul says, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. God sent, or God made him, meaning Jesus, who had no sin at all, to be sin for us, so that you and me in him, meaning his death and his resurrection, might become the righteousness of God. I love what Dr. Luke told a group of believers in the book of Acts chapter 4. He said, Jesus It was Dr. Luke repeating the words of Simon Peter, who was preaching to the religious leaders. He said, "Jesus, the stone you builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and salvation exists in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." Think about Jesus' earthly ministry, healing the deaf, the dumb, and the blind so that they could hear and speak and see again, healing the leprous from all of their physical diseases and infirmities so that they could be reunited with family and friends in society and community again, casting out demons from the possessed so they could live free from the chains of our enemy. He forgave sinners so that they could have the hope for a better tomorrow. He caused the lame to walk again and the dead to rise to walk and to breathe again and to have life. Think about that patient of my wife's who said, "Tell your pastor, never give up on anybody." He said, "Because I now have life in the message that I had so often rejected." Jesus lives. Christ Jesus lives today, and he wants to make a home in your heart. Yeah, so Jesus is the goat. Could have started there and ended there. But we want you to know how much we love you, but no one loves you more than God. And God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. That's what the Apostle Paul told the Romans. And by way of the Romans, God says to you and me, Jesus gave his life for you, so wouldn't you give him a chance? And if you'd be willing to, would you be willing to just simply reach out to God in prayer and say, "Oh God, I am. I agree. I admit I'm a sinner and I need you to save my soul. I've come to realize over time," and Pastor Charles has reiterated this again to me today, "that you are the only way to eternal life. And I don't know what the future holds, so I want to hold on to the one who indeed knows everything about the future. And so I give you my life today, oh God, and I ask you to save my soul. I come to you humbly to say, forgive me, and I'm trusting in your Son today to be my Savior and Lord." Listen, today, my dear friend, if that's the decision that you have made, we want you to reach out to us. You can do so on Facebook. You can do so on YouTube, where we host this Church on the Couch. You can do so by giving us a call, 770-957-5828. You can email me personally at charlesthomas@fbcmcdonough.com, or you can email the church at info@fbcmcdonough.com. We want to get a record of your decision today, though. Not for record's sake, but because we want to send you something into the mail this week that might encourage you and inspire you in this newfound walk, this newfound decision that you've made to follow Jesus. We love you and we're praying for you. We hope you have a great week, and we hope to see you the next time we gather. God bless.
We want to thank you so much for joining us in worship today at First Baptist Church. It's been a wonderful day of worship and praise and the Word. We hope that you have a great week, and we'll see you back here next week. Let's sing this together. Praise God.